G'day guys, and welcome to another episode of the Mindful Men podcast. My name is Simon Rennie, and I'm the man behind Mindful Men. I'm super excited. I always love talking to social workers around the world, and I've got Elise Mandich here from over the big blue in California. How are you going, Elise?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Thanks for joining me. It's super early over here and it's 1 o'clock over there, so I'm envious of the time of day, but that's okay. That's what we do as social workers. The Mindful Men podcast is a show that opens up conversations for men to start becoming mindful of who they are and how they can grow as people, whether it's mental or physical health, whether it's relationships, family, going to school, going to work, whatever it is. I just like to have conversations because men, you know, typically struggle to open up about things. So I'm super excited to have you on the show today because we're going to be talking about some big, big things that are happening over in the US, but are also having impacts across the world as well. And we'll go through those. But for anyone who's listening out there who might be triggered by things like suicide or abortion and gun control, it might be an episode to skip, and that's okay. But if you do stick around and something does trigger you, please reach out to your support networks afterwards and get any help that you need. So with that said, Elise, I'd love to hear a bit about your backstory, you know, where you grew up and family life and work and what you've been doing up until today.
Yeah, absolutely. That's like such a simple question for 30 years of life, you know. and I first just want to say I love, like, one, what you're doing, but two, just that, like, you're a dude doing it too. Like, it's really cool to meet men that are in this field, and yeah, I think we need more of that, so it's awesome.
Thank you, appreciate that.
So my name's Elise. I wish I could say, like, I've traveled the world and I grew up all over the place, but I didn't. I've born and raised in Southern California. I often make the joke that if you listen to me talk for 5 minutes, you'll probably guess that because I sound like a Valley girl. At this point, I just own it. But yeah, I grew up in Southern California, and I mean, we'll get to the trauma piece, but really besides like this traumatic event in my childhood, I had a really good childhood. I have a very big blended family. So I grew up with two different sets of parents, half siblings, step siblings, quote unquote, 100% biological sibling. But I've loved it. You know, we go 5 different places on every holiday and kind of like, I don't know, move around a lot with like bopping over all over the place. But I grew up loving it. And I still to this day, I do that. You know, we make our rounds and very family oriented. And I don't think I've ever lost that. I think even in my teenage years where, you know, I was with my friends a lot, like family's always been really, really important to me, which plays a big role, I think, in kind of like how I see people and the work that I do now and, you know, wanting to make sure that people create that too.
Yeah. Yeah. And you're a mom now?
I am. Yeah. I have 2 boys, 2 and 5.
Oh, same as us as well. So I'm expecting my 2.5-year-old to pop in here any moment when she wakes up.
Yes.
Tell me about being a mom and what it means to you.
Oh my gosh, I love it. I think that after losing my own mom, like being a mom was something super important to me. I mean, I was always like, you know, the little one carrying around dolls and Barbies and all of that, but it's something that I've always wanted and I love it. And it's more challenging than I ever thought it would be, which I'm sure you can relate to. I always like to tell people, like, I can know, quote unquote, a bunch of stuff from the books and like know the right thing to do, and I still make mistakes all the time, you know, because we're all our messy selves, regardless of the knowledge that we have. But I love it. I love my kids, and it truly is like that definition of unconditional love.
Yeah, yeah. And you're a social worker as well, working out of school, but you've just started your own business.
I did. Yeah. So I'm a licensed clinical social worker here. I am a high school social worker. And yeah, I just, as of yesterday, I think I posted, I opened up my own private practice that I'll be doing just part-time on the side, big empathy therapy. And so I'm really excited about that like new journey. I feel like I'm lots of imposter syndrome, but definitely excited.
Well, it's funny that you're going through this at the moment, because I'm in the process of setting up my own private practice as well. So I've been working in the same industry for 15 years in public service, but I finished my master's of social work last year and keen to jump out on my own. And I've got a lot of imposter syndrome at the moment. It's almost crippling sometimes. Yep. I don't like using that word, but yeah, I can certainly feel what you're feeling at the moment. And I'm excited to see how it grows, because I love watching your stuff on Instagram. So exciting times ahead. But yeah, your life, I guess, earlier in your childhood started off with a bit of trauma, as you mentioned before. And at 10 years, you lost your mum to suicide. Are you happy to tell a bit about that time and what happened? Not necessarily the specifics of what happened, but like how it made you feel and how it impacted family and stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. So at this time, when I, you know, I was 10 years old, I think I was going into the summer before fifth grade. Oh, that's a cute mug, by the way.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. It's a coffee mug for anyone listening.
Oh,
not,
yeah,
my, not my big mug.
He's just drinking out of a cute coffee mug. But yeah, it was honestly really crazy, because I think even now as a mental health professional, right, we see the warning signs, and at the time being 10 and very egocentric, like, you know, I don't think of anybody but myself, but I didn't see any of those signs with my mom. Even like thinking back, I never saw my mom as depressed. And I think that's important to the story for a few reasons. Like, one, I think my mom internalized a lot and maybe hid a lot of what was going on for her behind closed doors. It was also the 90s where mental health had huge stigma. Mm-hmm. It was just a really, really crazy time. Very shocking. I'd never heard of what that was, right? Nobody talked about it. I actually didn't know how my mom died until I want to say like a few days after, like a friend of mine told me. And I was like, oh, what? I thought she was just like got sick and died in the hospital. I don't know. But it was really, really hard time in our family. At the time I'd been living with my mom and my stepdad and my two half siblings that were my mom and my stepdad's, and then my biological brother. And we would like go back and forth to our dad's house.
Yeah.
And, my older brother is the one that unfortunately found my mom and has, I would say, significantly struggled the most out of everybody. But it was just a tough time, because not only did I lose my mom, and that's obviously extremely devastating, but then the way that you lose that parent is extremely devastating. And then watching just kind of the impact on my siblings, my stepdad, and then trickle into, like, we ended up moving with my dad and my stepmom. So then like my relationships with my siblings shifted and my stepdad, like it was just a really, really crazy time. I feel like when I think about it, it's almost hard to believe that was like a little version of me. Like it seems like somebody else.
Yeah.
And I don't think that people have to align with, like, you know, that whole saying that everything happens for a reason. Cause like, that's just a shitty reason. Like I wish that hadn't have happened. Though those were the cards that I was dealt, and I'm thankful for where I'm at. I'm thankful that I've been able to take this experience and not turn it into something good, but like just make sense of it in a way that's like meaningful to me, because I think mm-hmm. the work that I do is very meaningful because of that experience, if that makes sense.
Yeah, my psychologist calls it the wounded healer. Mm. So people have gone through trauma or, you know, significant impacts in their life. So for me, mental illness for 30 years or so. It's that willingness to use that trauma to help others and help ourselves and recover as well. It's a very difficult thing. It's not something that I probably was really reflective of until I got older, you know, into my 30s as well. So it can take a long time to kind of tune into it. Mm-hmm. Did you find that, like, after the incident, like, did you have a period where you weren't really yourself, or you were rediscovering yourself, or just trying to process that?
You know, it's funny, like to truly see repression as like a defense mechanism. Like I have repressed so much. There's a lot I don't remember. Like my parents mm-hmm. told us that they had us in therapy. I have no recollection of going, who I talked to. I remember, like, cause you know, middle school, a couple years later, I would write really dark poems about suicide, about death. And I wasn't feeling that way, but I think that was like my journey of processing a lot of what had happened. And then recently, actually, I did EMDR, and related to something else. And of course, as we know, with trauma, like so many of the things about my childhood with my mom and those things were coming up. But I think in ways as a child, I don't know if I would have recognized this. I think I developed a lot of like need for control. Like, and I noticed that in myself, you know, my teenage years, and anxiety, of course, but like, I just genuinely think I hold on to like, even like a fight or an argument with people. Like my first thought is like, okay, if something happens to this person tomorrow, are you okay with how you left things?
Yeah.
And I have to find ways of like balancing that. But I remember feeling that growing up and like just not understanding it really. And I think it developed into kind of like more people pleasing tendencies, but unraveling a lot of that as I've gotten older.
Yeah. And how has it impacted you as a mom now, like in terms of your relationship with your kids?
Yeah. Truthfully speaking, it's sometimes hard for me to wrap my head around like how my mom did that in the sense of like, oh my God, I can't imagine getting to a place where I would genuinely feel that my kids are better off without me. That's like it's difficult for me to understand. But two, I think it makes me want to make sure that I'm like there for my kids. You know, I have truly at this point right now in my life, I'm not angry at my mom for what happened. I think that she was really sick, didn't know what to do, didn't have the resources. It was a split decision. But I'm really thankful for where mental health is at now. And as I struggle or as things come up for me, that I know I can reach out and help myself so that I can, you know, better help like the outcome for my kids and the impact that I have on them in their life.
Yeah. Yeah. And I guess we're going to touch on in soon around the impact for kids. And there's a lot of stuff happening over there in terms of gun control and so forth. But I'm always interested to hear about why people get into social work. And I'm wondering, did your experience with your mom, what happened there, was that something that drove you towards social work?
You know, I think like unconsciously, yes. It's funny, my senior year of high school, we had to do a senior project and I chose to like essentially do my project on a licensed marriage and family therapist, family friend, and became really interested in the work, play therapy, all of these things. But I don't think I, at that point, had connected at all, like what that truly meant. I like knew I was interested in psychology and that was what I initially went to school for undergrad. But no, I don't think that those dots really connected until like I've become more aware of just like, where did that come from? And maybe it's a combination of just who I am as a person and that, but I think it would be kind of like crazy for me to think that that hasn't strongly influenced me. And initially I went into the child protective services system. That's where I spent my first few years working. And as I was writing into graduate school, basically this like little mini paper to apply to work. Oh my gosh, I'm not going to get into the specifics, but about child welfare. I talked about the connection and not at all to compare, but you know, even having to move homes into a different family with a different set of siblings, these things, and I knew them, right? But it wasn't the same. I didn't grow up with them day to day. How difficult that transition must have been, and like kind of helped me think of like a parallel to those kids that are getting pulled from their home and placed with another family on some small level. Yeah. So all of those experiences have definitely like tied into, you know, where I'm at now and the journey of getting here.
Yeah. And you mentioned just before that you did your undergrad in psychology. Was that right?
I started and then I switched it to human development.
Yeah. So it's actually a very common thing that, you know, I experienced that as well. I started psychology and then I switched over to anthropology in my undergrad. And it wasn't until I became a mature age student a long way after that I did social work. But why did you switch over from psychology? What was the push there?
I think when I got into school, psychology, at least at the school I was going to specifically, was very heavily like research. And while that was like a fascinating component, I was missing kind of like the theories. And then human development, I think I realized, was more aligned with what I thought psychology was going in at 18 years old. And I switched to like a minor in psychology. And that's where understanding like personality disorders and just all of the like mental health world where it like kind of came together.
Yeah. I think I got there was probably a research focus as well for our undergrad psychology, and this was back in 2000, early 2000s for me. And I got to there was one around statistics, and I was thinking to myself, why am I going to use statistics helping people work out what's happening in their brain? And I was never good at math, so that's why I dropped out. But it's funny because when I went back and did my master's of social work, we did exactly the same subject of why I dropped out of psychology in the first place. And I found myself going full circle, but I managed to get through it this time. I think I was a bit more committed this time than I was when I was a lot younger. So
statistics is the only class I ever had to retake because I failed it in college. It was awful. We had this awful professor that made us, he wanted us to understand it conceptually. So we weren't allowed to use calculators in a stats class.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Old school.
Yeah. I'm sure some people loved it. It was not for me though.
Definitely not for me. I couldn't wait to get out of that class fast enough. Yeah. So, but you're a clinical social worker and a high school social worker. So what's the difference between the two?
I mean, I think it's right. Like social workers, we work in all different types of environments. School social work, the way I kind of explain it, especially let's just say to parents, as I'm like taking on their kiddo, is I'm not a replacement for outside support. I can provide mental health support at school, but it's usually good until that person is connected or in addition to. So like, for example, I run groups. That's amazing, but it's not a replacement for them receiving that support outside of school. I can't diagnose in my role at school. And my caseload's gigantic compared to what I would be in like a full private practice setting. So a lot of the kids that I see for the most part are pretty high risk, chronically suicidal. They were referred to me after a suicide attempt or because of the suicidal ideation. And so usually it's getting them connected to services and then helping support them at school so that especially if they're struggling academically or to get there or anything like that, I can help kind of bridge that gap between home and school.
Yeah, I'm really fascinated because with this aspect of your career because in our Masters of Social Work, we have to do 1,000 hours of prac work. So I cut over two blocks of 500 and my first 500 hours was in a high school working in the school chaplaincy. So we're doing a lot of social work. So we worked with some really smart students that were like the leaders of the school in different projects like volunteering and helping them connect with community and so forth, but also students that were struggling and you know, some with disabilities, some with just didn't want to be in school. And we were doing like little group projects on the side. I think we had like a little greenhouse that we were helping kids learn how to plant and little woodworking classes and so forth. So you mentioned group work in the school. Well, first of all, before I go into the specifics of your school social work, what's it like working in a school environment for you?
I love it. Like I said, I came from the child welfare system or child protective services, and I don't always do well with change. So leaving that was hard. I didn't really know what to expect. And I know we'll get into this, but ironically, leaving a system like that where I was doing investigations, first one knocking on the door, some scary stuff, some scary situations. I felt more nervous going into a school because I was fearful of school shootings than I was in my previous job.
Yeah.
So that was like really interesting, but yeah, I really like it. I think it's a cool place to be because you are so accessible to kids that I feel like I get to connect with kids who, one, are like, I'm not going to talk to a therapist. And then they're like, oh, you're a therapist? Maybe I'll talk to you. So you really get to see kids, get to shift their perspective of what it's like to even talk to a mental health professional. And then two, I think just like being in a position to provide like psychoeducation to a place where kids already are. It's not inconvenient, right? Like they don't have to schedule it. I'm on campus. I pull kids from class, you know, and it's a great place to be.
Yeah. Think back to your first few days or your first few weeks or months at the school. How did you go building rapport with the kids? Because I found I didn't have any street cred in the yard at all. Yeah. And I'm just like this weird guy. Like for me, it was like going back to high school, but like I'm walking through now and people calling me sir and all sorts of weird things. And I'm like, oh, where's all the big kids? Like I got to keep away from there. Like even, and I was in my mid 30s saying this in my head. Like, so I had a lot of like, I guess, my own experiences of high school coming up. But yeah, how did you go with building the rapport with the students that you work with? Was it easy for you, or you found it difficult?
I found it pretty easy. I think that, like, I humbly say this, of all the things I'm really good at, I think building relationships is like up there for me. And I truly spent my first year just like, look, I don't really know what I'm doing in this role yet, but I know how to build relationships. And so I think establishing that, not just with the students, but the teachers and the staff too, and like building that credibility. But with kids, I honestly like played into the like millennial thing. They like to make fun of us, and I just kind of like leaned into it. So I'd make jokes about my skinny jeans, and like I'd make them guess how old I was, and just really like listen to them. And I think that's what's really cool. And I hate saying this, it's kind of sad, but like so many adults don't listen and judge and criticize like teenagers. And it's like, you were there too. Like, just hear them out. And they're a really, really cool like population of kids. And I think that when they sense that, and like, you're just respectful and listen, like the credibility came just from that. And then over time, it's, so I just finished my fourth year. So like kids that I had as a freshman just graduated this past year, you know, friends start to talk and they get to know like, oh, okay. So they hear my name, or they, you know, hear an announcement from me. And I think just like that reputation starts to spread.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember Chappie who said that he's been there 7 years, and he's a social worker, but he comes from that community development perspective and sustainability and things like that. And he was saying that for the first year, he didn't have any street cred either, and he'll just go play basketball at lunchtime or handball at lunchtime and talk about pop culture for kids, you know, like at their age. And that's a great way to connect with students, particularly for adults, as we kind of forget, you know, how to be kids. But it's also a good place to kind of rediscover that inner child within us, I think.
It is. And just meeting them where they're at. And you realize, and I think it's cool, like getting creative like that, like going and playing basketball with them, or ideally, it doesn't always happen this way, but getting out at like lunchtime or breaks, and just, you know, like you get to have these like unique relationships and connecting with them about their interests, that I think just opens that relationship up. It opens up that opportunity.
Yeah. Now, without mentioning any specifics about the kind of work you do, like what's some of the themes that some of the students bring up with you in terms of what's worrying them or what's on their mind and what they're trying to work through?
Truthfully, like a little bit of everything. So, and the way that my role functions, I'm considered like a tier two support. So, you know, tier one would be like their counselor. We have multiple counselors on site who, let's say they go to their counselor and they're crying, right? And the counselor is like, what's going on? And they start opening up. Well, after a certain amount of those check-ins, or when they learn what's going on, they might refer them to me. So very, very rarely am I like the first point of contact sometimes, but for the most part, a lot of the kids that I see, again, struggle with suicidal ideation, depression, anxiety, trauma. I've had quite a few girls who've experienced rape and sexual assault, like family challenges. I work with a lot of our LGBTQ population, so a lot of our trans and non-binary kids who are just struggling oftentimes with like family support, or actually socially. A lot of the kids, we have a very accepting community and, well, school campus for sure. But yeah, I would say just a little bit of all of those things.
Yeah. And you mentioned before that you were worried about school shootings, and when we were teeing up this interview, we had unfortunately another one over in the US, and I think we've had another one since then from memory. Yeah. It's something that from this part of the world, we wonder why it keeps happening. And I, as a dad myself, and you know, previously worked in a school environment, the thought of sending my kids to school and they might not coming home is very scary. What's it like living over there and working over there in a school environment with this kind of, you know, what if type moment that could happen any day?
I'm going to answer that with the part of being a mom too. I'm sending my 5-year-old to kindergarten next year, or this upcoming school year. And he's going to public school. And I would be lying if I didn't say that every time I drive by the school, I'm looking at, like, because I know where the classes are, and I'm like, oh, like, it's one of those things that crosses my mind. And, you know, we had this conversation with our neighbors the other day who are actually possibly moving to New Zealand, and this being a huge reason of their fear. And we were talking about, like, on the general scale, you know, the likelihood is very small, but it's very scary because it only takes one person, you know, and it's so, you know, if I'm taking off my social work hat and just speaking as, like, a human, as a parent, as a human that works in a school, like, it's scary. And I think what, and I'm sure you feel this way too, it's frustrating sometimes, this, like, point to, like, mental health, because it's so much more than that. Like, it it can be a mental health issue. You know, I can understand why people say, like, well, somebody that would do this, right? Like, they can't be mentally, quote unquote, sane, whatever the arguments are. But it, I think what just drives me absolutely insane is nobody, most people are not trying to take away everyone's guns. We are looking for control to make sure that as best we can, we prevent guns from getting in the wrong hands, right? Like, just more screening. And I know multiple people who have had access to guns that I'm like, did you guys ask any of these questions? Like, was what was the waiting period? And I don't know enough about guns to fully speak on everything, but I just wish there was more preventative actions. And it's like bonkers to me how this stuff keeps happening. And, like, if anything, they get, like, gun laws are getting loosened. Like, I just, it genuinely blows my mind.
Yeah, we had a similar experience in the 90s. We had Port Arthur Massacre, which was, Port Arthur was like a historical convict site for Australia. And someone went in and used some guns and shot a whole bunch of people and killed a whole bunch of people, kids included. But from there, the Australian government, they just put a ban on it. They said, bring your guns in. And everyone brought their guns in and said, no, we don't want this to happen again. And that was it. And we still have gun violence with the, you know, in the organized crime, but not so much. Like, it would be unspeakable to hear of something happening in a school, you know, or a church, or a public place. It's usually between warring gangs or whatever. So we always, I think the question that always comes up for an Australian, and you know, obviously I'm Australian, and is why the government just doesn't do that. I mean, I know that the NRA has got a bit of sway in the politics and so forth, but I always come back to that Simpsons episode where Homer uses the Constitution to wipe his face. He's been eating food and stuff like that. And, like, it just seems like to us it's just a piece of paper, but this people really hold on to those rights over there. And can you tell us a bit about that kind of patriotism to that piece of paper?
Yeah, I think what's interesting too is just, and right, I think of people who just think in very black and white, and on both ends of the spectrum. And I'll just, I mean, even, like, politically, like, I identify as very liberal, but I'm not so black and white that I'm not able to get curious or, like, or move. And I think that's where I struggle, is that people that hold on, like you're saying, to this piece of paper as if it's black and white, the end all be all, and are not open to taking it and adapting it. Again, like, I think I'm not even looking for a complete ban. That, you know, in so many ways, in so many areas, be awesome, but can we do anything to just move forward, to progress? Because that's what happens in society and culture. And as we see things become a problem, we can make adjustments. And I think what truly, like, makes me the saddest is that I feel like until, this is just like a personal thought, but until people experience these awful things personally, they're not willing to budge. But if you were to put you, your family, your kids in a situation like that, would your mind shift? And if it would, then why are we not making adaptions right now? Because I don't know. It just, it's so sad and it's so scary. And I think what you said, like, it's almost like even here in prisons, there's, like, and maybe everywhere, but, like, kind of the, from what I hear, the, like, unwritten rule that people who abuse children, like, they're, like, the black sheep of the prison, right? Like, why is that not it, like, with guns too? Like, gang violence, all that. I mean, I get, you're right. There's, people are probably going to get guns into their hands regardless, because a lot of that's through illegal activity. But how many of these mass shootings have been committed by people who've been able to legally access these guns is, like, on another level.
Yeah, it's, I haven't been to the US, but I've heard stories of people walking to, like, shopping, like, grocery stores, and, you know, you've got your fruit, veggies, your meat, and you got your guns. You know, like it's,
I live in California, so like not here, but in it, you know, even like I'm sure more like open carry states and that kind of stuff, it's probably more like that. But yeah, I mean, it's, I would say even most people I know like own a gun. A lot of people I know own guns. Interesting.
It's a different world, I guess. You know, as you said, different world, different things as well. But with all the, I guess, the gun violence and so forth, like, and actually being in a school, like, I guess the school would have some sort of measures to put in place to try and protect kids and students. Like, what's it like at your school?
I think a lot of it is like, you know, being like a closed campus. So it's, you know, completely gated, and the goal and the effort is to make sure that, you know, doors get closed behind as staff come in, like doors shut, just to make it harder on people to get in. Everybody that comes on the campus is supposed to go through like the front office. Especially during COVID, other measures were taking place. So we really don't have like visitors and that kind of stuff. We actually, our school, and I don't know the name of the system, but just is initiating a system that I think it's basically like an app where like any staff, if anybody has it, and let's say an active shooting were to happen, and you can hear it, you can press this button and notifies everybody, and it can push the school into a lockdown.
Yeah.
Because prior to that, until the message gets around, you know, people's doors are still could be unlocked. I personally keep my, like, I have an office inside our main like administration building, and then I have a classroom where I run my groups. My classroom I keep unlocked for the first like passing period in the first maybe 3 minutes, and then I lock it just as an extra precaution. And for me personally, I'm just always in the mindset of, if something were to happen, right, if I'm in my office, where could I hide this individual student I'm seeing in myself? If I'm in my room, where could we go? What would we do? But we have like active shooter drills, and it's like a run, hide, fight model, where basically you try to run first if you can. If you can't run, you hide. If you can't hide, you fight.
It's just bewildering that you have to go through something like that in a place where you'd think it's one of the most safest places in the world. I get speechless sometimes thinking about it. But I guess this is not the only thing that's on the minds of kids. We've also had some other big stuff happening over in the US, and we've had the recent US Supreme Court overturning the Roe versus Wade decision around abortion laws in the US. Can you tell us a bit about what's been happening over there and how that's impacting women, and also, you know, young students, female students who might be, you know, experience rape or even just an unplanned pregnancy and so forth? Like, what's the feeling like on the ground there?
You know, and I'll speak, I live in a very, if I'm speaking to my small bubble, I live in a very conservative, more, you know, quote unquote Republican community. Work in a more Republican community. And I live in California. So the laws here specific to abortion have not changed, right? If I wanted to go get an abortion, I still have access in my state right now. I think that, again, it's just not just speaking to my situation and me as a person, and I'm not speaking about me, but anybody, but like looking at what are the other things, what are the reasons people may get? And I think people get really hung up on like, we'll just use contraception. And it's like, but we have seen firsthand, there's been stories that have gone around of, I think there was like a 10-year-old in a certain state who was raped and pregnant and unable to get an abortion in her state. And now she has to travel out of state. And then some of these states are putting laws into place where they could be criminalized for going out of state to get an abortion. So I feel like, and I don't know, again, enough, I feel like every state, it's like everybody functions like their own little kingdom within our giant state or giant country. But it's just so sad. Like, it's crazy to see us like take these steps backwards, truly. And again, for people to not have the ability to see, I guess, the other side of the coin with things. Again, just like gun control, I'm okay. If you need to regulate and like only certain exceptions after a certain amount of time, fine. But we have to look into what this means for every single angle. And until they adapt all of that information, it leaves way too much for ambiguity. And you've got doctors having to consult with people, to make sure that they're legally okay. And like, now we're putting the mom's life at risk. Mm-hmm. And what does that mean? How much at risk does the mom have to be able to perform? Right. I haven't been at work or in school since this like overturned, but, I mean, I know I've had at least one student that's had an abortion since I've worked in the school system. And like, I can't imagine like, you know, just telling, I don't know, like telling a person what to do with their body. Like, I know that's just like my opinion on it, but it's really difficult to try and understand. And I think until you're sitting in front of that person hearing their story, it's easy to make judgments or develop an opinion. But
I think about that 10-year-old you mentioned before, like the trauma that she's obviously gone through already just to get pregnant, and then trying to, I guess, you know, go through an abortion and I guess not fix it, because you can't fix that trauma, but kind of put it to a side and get the abortion, but then also now be faced with, you know, being criminalized for trying to move and go out of the state to get that. It's just, that would, to me, would be the moment that every lawmaker would go, okay, well, this is the reason why we have these laws in the first place. Not so much, you know, anything else, but this 10-year-old, that would be, for me, if I was a lawmaker, that would be the thing that keeps me saying, no, we're not gonna overturn this for this reason.
Yeah. And that's what's unfortunate, is I think a lot of, you know, the other side, I hear people's like, well, it's up to the states. And if people, they can just go, well, maybe they can, maybe they won't be criminalized, but maybe they don't have access. Maybe they don't have the money to jump on a plane to go and do that. And even incest, like I think of when I worked for CPS, I had seen incest, and what happens like biologically to that baby that's born that has all these complications and issues, like that's not a life for them either. And I've seen babies eventually die because of the results and the impacts of incest on the body, right? So it's just, again, I think sometimes things get put into place, like a lot of things, without thinking through all the nuance of it all. And unfortunately, it affects a lot of people, even to the point where, you know, people can die. And it's,
Or people, you know, people move overseas to live in a place or interstate where they might not have the support networks or the community around them that they grew up with, just to try and live a free life. It's another thing that's happened over there that has reverberated over here. So as I mentioned at the start, I'm not sure if we're recording at the time, is a couple of weeks ago, my family went to Brisbane, which is, you know, the capital of Queensland, only an hour down the road, for like a little getaway for the weekend. And the kids heard this noise that was coming from outside of the hotel room, and we were right in the middle of the city, and we all jumped out onto the balcony to have a look, and it was protesting this exact law change. And so, like, you know, the women and men as well, you know, in Australia were really, I guess, have been impacted by this, and sending our love and support over to those experiencing some hardship because of this particular decision.
That support, I love that.
Yeah, oh, definitely. And whatever happens over in the US, it certainly comes over here. We do read a lot about what's happening over there, and you know, and we're with you in terms of our support, you know, in certain different levels. So now I'm keen to hear about the big empathy energy that you've got behind you. You're a new business owner, and it's something that's very exciting for, I guess, a lot of people that are interested in private practice. So tell us about how this all come about and why you've wanted to go down this route.
So I'll say that, like, when I first got on social media, as far as like a quote unquote more professional account, was during COVID, like many people. We were, you know, I just had another baby. I was like, there's nothing to do.
Nothing to do.
Nothing to do. I mean, I take care of my baby, but like, you know, you can't go anywhere. It was during lockdown. And I initially started it as a book idea that I had, and I still have this idea. It's just kind of taken a backseat to everything right now, but that's how it started. And then over time it started to develop into more of like who I am. I think what's been really cool on a personal note from all of this is, even when I went into like graduate school, I always felt like I didn't quite fit in, like I couldn't really be myself. And I think getting onto social media and meeting more people who I kind of align, like, okay, that's good. I say like and a lot. I cuss. I'm very like, I like style. Like I'm very like, I just want to be me. And I felt this shift in like, not so much feeling like I'm putting on my mom's like work clothes as I'm walking into work to like, I'm going to show up as myself. And so that's just kind of evolved into, oh my God, it would be cool if I had like mental health merchandise and like, what's like a, I was, you know, just one day came up with a play on words of big empathy energy. Empathy is super important to me. I think empathy can do a lot for all of us. And it was like a way to bring kind of like cool vibes into mental health, which helps with the stigma. And yeah, I feel like I like proudly represent it. It's cool to like to wear it on campus again. Like it kind of gives me some street cred, I think, with the kids, I don't know. And then the private practice piece just kind of came from, I'm always like going for goals. Like I'm always like wanting to kind of develop professionally and personally and just as a human, but I love what I do within the school. And I kind of felt like there was this piece missing, and I have been very afraid of like the entrepreneur world of like, mm-hmm. well, I don't want to fail. And like, also, I don't know what I'm doing and they didn't teach me any of this. So I don't know where to go. But again, this amazing community online, I think a lot of people have been, it's motivating to see all these people, especially for me as a woman, seeing all these women that own their own practices and are doing it. I'm like, oh, well, like if they can do it, why can't I do it? Mm-hmm. So that's just kind of the catch-all, but it's been really cool. And yeah, I'm not going to pretend like I know it all. I don't, but really, really thankful for community, because prior to talking to you, I spent an hour talking to a friend who mm-hmm. answered a million questions for me. And it's been cool.
Yeah. When you were designing your private practice, like, did you think about shifting up or shaking up about how you deliver therapy? Because that's something that's been on my mind as I'm trying to think about my businesses, is I don't want to be, you know, six sessions a day just listening to stuff. I actually want to be more active, or, you know, just shake it up a bit for men, because coming to therapy for men particularly is challenging. I'm used to it now. I've been doing it for a long time, and but a lot haven't done it before. So have you thought about, you know, just shaking up things a bit and doing things a little bit differently, or are you going to stick to the traditional just talk therapies? And
I mean, for now, like eventually I love trauma, obviously. Mm-hmm. So like I want to learn things like EMDR and that kind of stuff. When I think of shaking up, I think of like, I don't know. When I think of therapy, the cliche therapy, right? I think of very like Freudian, like you're sitting on this couch, you're staring at a wall. I'm like taking notes. I have like a flat affect. Like, no, I'm going to bring myself into the room with you. I'm going to cuss. I'm going to laugh with you. I'm probably going to ask to see pictures of your kids. Like I want to be a human sitting in that room, virtual room, whatever, with that person. And I will say, even when I was like picking my branding colors and like shifting things on my Instagram and then designing my website, I'm like, man, if I do hot pink, I may not get a lot of men. And I'm like, you know what? Like maybe a dude will come to me. Cool. But if not, like, this is who I am. And if somebody goes into my website and sees that I use the word badass in my description and it's not for them, that's okay. Like, but I'm going to put myself out there authentically and for who I am. And the people that align with that are going to reach out, and it might be a great fit because of that, because I'm not, traditional. And I think that a lot of people are going to hate on that, but I also think that it's going to open the door for a lot of people who've been hesitant to start or to come. And I'm just going to be myself in an ethical, legal way.
I think that's fantastic. Yeah. Bringing yourself into it, because I think personality comes a long way in the therapy yeah. space. If you don't connect with the person who's giving you therapy, then it just doesn't work. You don't really buy into it. So I think for a lot of guys, if, you know, they might not come if you've got hot pink on the walls or whatever, but they also might come because you're more human than a 50 or 60 year old or 70 year old psychiatrist who's been doing it for 50 years and doesn't look up from that piece of paper and while you're talking. So I'm excited for it. I mean, I'd love to be over there getting some therapy. That's the kind of thing I look for as a therapist, because I find it easy to talk to women as opposed to men. But I also want to be there for men to try and help them open up as well when I eventually get started. So I think it sounds very exciting, and I'm keen to follow this pathway that you're on and maybe pick your brains over time and see how maybe some of the things that you've learned as you've been opening up your business and learning along the way as well.
Absolutely. I am no gatekeeper. I feel like everything I learn is learning through the people who have not gatekeeped as well and have helped me along the way.
Yeah, it's very social work of you.
You know, I feel like we all have that little piece in us, you know?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I've loved that chat. We could chat all day, I think, but I am mindful that you've got to head off soon. And my kids are about to break down the door in a minute because they want their dad to come and have some breakfast. A couple more questions, then I'll let you go. So what's some advice that you could give to a student who might be in school, really struggling, but they don't even know where to start or how to open up? And they might have seen you walking through the schoolyard. They want to come and say hi, but they're too scared to. What advice could you give them to make that leap and say hello?
I think the first thing that kind of comes to my mind is like, nothing changes if nothing changes. And if you realize that whatever's going on for you, however you're doing things, isn't working, like even if that's like, I don't need to talk to anybody, if you're recognizing that's not really working for you or things are getting worse, like, why not try something different? What do you have to lose? And I know that it can be really scary to be vulnerable, but just find one, you know, if it's on campus specifically, like one adult you can trust. It doesn't need to be a therapist, a social worker, a counselor. Maybe it's your coach, maybe it's a teacher, but somebody that you trust, and start there. Because I think when you start to see that people are empathetic and can embrace your vulnerability and validate whatever is going on for you, it allows for the opportunity to like, oh, that wasn't so bad. Maybe I can talk to someone. And then like, you can, you know, kind of move from there to whoever you need to speak to.
I love that. And you touched on one of my favorite quotes of nothing changes if nothing changes. It's one of my favorites. Would you say the same thing to someone who's thinking about touching base with you in your private practice, or would that be slightly different type of response?
What do you mean?
In terms of if they want to get therapy, they're not sure where to go, they've never done therapy before, and they see big empathy marketed all over social medias, would you give the same advice to make them make that phone call to you?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, and I tell people like, do your research, you know, and especially obviously not everybody takes insurance. A lot of private practice owners do not take insurance in our system here, but like, figure out what it is like about you and start looking for somebody that you think might align. And I think you said it in our conversation the best, that if you don't have that relationship with the person, it's not going to work. And I don't remember where I read this. I don't know if it's true, so don't like quote it as fact, but I read 70% of your success in therapy has to do with the relationship. And so just finding somebody that's a good fit, like, you know, because I think there's a benefit to people that have been doing this work for 40 years. They have so much knowledge and so much experience, and that's all great. But if you can't develop a relationship with that person, then what's the point? So,
yeah. And it's certainly okay to change therapists as well. Like, you don't have to stick with one if it's not working.
Absolutely.
And a good social worker's out there like yourself. I'm sure, you know, they all happy to help find another person as well. That's part of what we do in social work. So is Big Empathy up and running? How do people get in touch if they want to touch base with you?
Yeah, so I have Big Empathy Energy merchandise, that kind of stuff on my Relatable Social Worker, so that relatablesocialworker.com. And then I have, if you're in California, specifically looking for therapy, you can find me and access like the types of services I provide at bigempathytherapy.org.
Wonderful. And I'll get those links off of you and I'll put them in the show notes so everyone can touch base if they want to. But the last question I give, and I like to give this to everybody, is for you to plug something that you're enjoying. It could be a good resource, whether or not it's in social work, mental health, or it could be what you're watching on TV or some cool music that you're listening to. Think about your inner school social worker and this is what what's making you groove at the moment. Whatever you want to plug is up to you. It could be your business if you want to stick with your business. Up to you.
No, you know what? I'm going to pull away from all things, even mental health, and just say, one, I enjoy good trash TV. I think it's a great way to disconnect. We've got the Kardashians, Bachelor, all of those fun shows. And let me pull it up, but I came across this new artist and I love his music. I've been playing his song on repeat. Louyah, Louyah. And it's a song called You. But yeah, I think that I in general, like, love music. I'm a big Bruce Springsteen fan and love just kind of disconnecting and hearing, like, you know, the heart and the soul of people. So I love like singer songwriter music, and just encourage people. I know, especially like absorbing content like this, whether we're listening or we're reading it, like it's all fantastic. And we've got to get away from that sometimes and just disconnect and connect with what's going on around us.
Perfect. And I'll get the link to that song as well, so yeah, that people can tune in. So Elise, thanks so much for your time. I really do appreciate you coming on, and I love watching you on the Instagram and the posts that you do. It's very, very relatable as a social worker, but also as a parent and a human as well. So I really do appreciate your time.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
If you enjoyed today's episode, make sure that you like it and leave a comment, and then share it with your mates. Also, subscribe to the channel and hit that notification bell so that you don't miss a moment of future episodes to come.